Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to Followers of the Way this morning. Well, it's been quite a week for news, hasn't it? I was listening to the BBC before we came on the service a few minutes ago, and it was full of this row about Les Anderson and the events in Parliament last week. I don't know about you, but I was really shocked to see that slogan just illuminated over the Elizabeth Tower, from the river to the sea, Palestine shall be free. The police did absolutely nothing to stop it. I mean, it's just incredible, isn't it? Because to me, that was pure intimidation by pro-Palestinian groups on to the Mother of Parliaments. It's just incredible. And then put against that, this rise in anti-Semitism in the country. And I am seriously concerned about what's going on here. And I do think, to a large extent, that actually Christians have allowed this situation to develop, because over the last years, we really haven't stood up for our faith. I don't know if you've all seen, but in our Voice for Justice mailing a couple of days ago, I wrote about plans by Bournemouth City Council to impose a 20 mile per hour speed limit across all streets in Bournemouth, Christchurch, and Poole. It's a massive area, actually. And there was an article in the local newspaper, and it said that the police were against this proposal, the local transport was against this proposal, and businesses aren't too happy about this proposal. But the council apparently is pressing ahead. And it said that they were anticipating protests, and there was a quote from the council saying that they were especially anticipating protests from white, Christian, heterosexual, non-disabled males. I mean, what an extraordinary thing to say when you think about it, because to me, that indicates a really terrifying underlying agenda. Well, quite a lot of people have got back to us already, some asking how they can protest about this, which is very encouraging. And we will be sending out some advice on that next week. But two emails in particular stood out to me. One said, "As a country, we are now facing our Dunkirk moment." And the other said, "Linda, why are you always so depressing? Why can't you be more optimistic? Can't you just remind us that in Christ we have the victory and that he knows what's going on and we don't need to worry?" Oh, I wish I could. I actually think both these emails are true, but I think it would be a huge mistake just to reassure people. Sorry, I just had a little flash up saying that I'd gone muted, so I was a bit astonished by that, but I think you're all still hearing me. For Christ's victory to become manifest in our country, it needs for us to acknowledge the truth and to stand up for it. It needs for us to act on that truth. But of course, to do that, we have to be really clear of what it is we actually believe. We have to know the basics of our faith, the origins of our faith, what it is that God has done for us in Christ, what it is that he is doing at this moment. And we need to really know that it's a spiritual battle that we're in. We need to know too what it means when the Bible says that the Jews are God's chosen people. Chosen for what? Why are they chosen? We need to know that from Scripture. And we need to know what it is that God's doing. We need to know what that means for us and for the world today. Because that's the only way that we'll be able to even begin to understand why there's so much hatred for Israel. Why there's so much hatred for Christians in the world? It's a spiritual battle. Well, of course, that is a part of what we are exploring in our series, The Jewishness of Jesus, which Paul Luckraft is very kindly leading for us. And of course, Jesus was born a Jew. He was born in the Promised Land, And God gave that land to the Jews as an eternal possession. So we're really pleased this morning to welcome Paul back to us. And he's going to be speaking about Jesus, the Jewish child. So, Paul, very warm welcome. I'm really looking forward to what it is you've got to say to us. Just one last thing I must mention there before we start is that we had news this week of the passing of Denzel Nana. Denzel was a really staunch servant of Christ, and he was a very faithful part of Followers of the Way. And I think he joined us right from the beginning, trying to remember. Anyway, Denzel became ill some weeks ago and was admitted to hospital. I think I'm right in saying that he was allowed back home quite recently, and he died peacefully, I'm told, with his family all around him. So just this morning, we want to give real thanks for his life, entrusting him to the care of our Lord, the Lord that he loves so much. And we do pray for Denzel's family at this time, especially for his daughter Suzanne and for his son-in-law Jonty. So we pray the Lord's blessing for them. So, as we begin our worship, let's just take a moment to still our hearts and our minds. And let's just ask the Lord to be here with us now in power and to lead us. So let's pray. Father God, we come to you with hearts and minds caught up in so many things. Lord, with all the concerns of the world, with worries for families, for Lord, just generally, our minds are teeming. And we pray now, Lord, that you will still our hearts and minds. Give to us your peace, Lord, that we might, by your grace, enter into your presence, that we might hear your voice, that we might feel your love more powerfully, and that we might be built up in your truth. Holy Spirit, please be with us now. Lead us in all we say, in all we do, in all we think. And we ask your anointing for Paul as he speaks to us. But Lord, your blessing for each one, that we might, in this time together now, be blessed and anointed by your Spirit to become soldiers of Christ and to be obedient to you. In Jesus' name, Amen. So we're going to have now a time of worship.
As we are gathered. sustains the stars and planets, yet in his wisdom laid aside his crown. Jesus, the man who washed our feet, who bore our suffering, became a curse to bring salvation's plan. This King of love, the price is paid, the chains are loosed, and we're forgiven, and we can run into these arms of God.
Well, we come now to a time of confession. We want to confess before God for our part how we have not failed to, we have failed to uphold his name, because we know that we have been forgiven by Christ's death on the cross. But we have fallen short so often in the ways, and we haven't defended his name and stood up for him. But more than that, our nation has not stood up for our sovereign Lord, for the one who has blessed us down the centuries. So now, please, let us stand together in the gap, and let us make our confession for ourselves, yes, but on behalf of this nation, that in the Lord's name and by his grace, we might reopen a door, that this nation will stand up for our sovereign Lord, our Redeemer, our Saviour. So as we say together the words of the confession, let us in the Spirit open that door for Christ to come in, that our nation may stand again. So we say now, Almighty God, our Father, we have done wrong. We have tarnished the gift you gave freely. We have buried you so deeply in our hearts, the world doesn't see you. We have not followed Christ. We have ignored your teachings. We have lived lives of apathy against your love. We have built fences and fortresses to push people away. And we have silenced the screams of those in need. Forgive us, Father, we pray. Free us now from our sin, Lord, in your love, in your mercy. Free us to a life lived in joy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we ask that our nation may become faithful witnesses of Christ. And we ask it in the absolute assurance that God loves us and he hears us and he is so quick to forgive. So may the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us now to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So I'm going to invite Leslie now to come and give us our readings. We have two readings this morning. Leslie.
The first reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 7, verses 1 to 17. When Ahaz, son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, was king of Judah, King Rezin of Aram and Pekah, son of Remaliah, king of Israel, marched up to fight against Jerusalem, but they could not overpower it. Now the house of David was told, Aram has allied itself with Ephraim. So the hearts of Ahaz and his people were shaken, as the trees of the forest are shaken by the wind. Then the Lord said to Isaiah, go out, you and your son Shear-Jashub, to meet Ahaz at the end of the aqueduct of the upper pool, on the road to the launderer's field. Say to him, be careful, keep calm, and don't be afraid. Do not lose heart because of these two smouldering stubs of firewood, because of the fierce anger of Rezin and Aram and the son of Remaliah. Aram, Ephraim, and Remaliah's son have plotted your ruin, saying, let us invade Judah, let us tear it apart and divide it among ourselves, and make the son of Tabeel king over it. Yet this is what the sovereign Lord says. It will not take place, it will not happen, for the head of Aram is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is only Rezin. Within 65 years, Ephraim will be too shattered to be a people. The head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is only Remaliah's son. If you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or the highest heights. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear now, you house of David, is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. He will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. For before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. The Lord will bring on you and on your people and on the house of your father a time unlike any since Ephraim broke away from Judah. He will bring the king of Assyria. The second reading is taken from Matthew chapter 2, verses 13 to 23. The escape to Egypt. When they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, he said, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search the child to kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I call my son." When Herod realized that he'd been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious and gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity, who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. "A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more." After Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who are trying to take the child's life are dead." So he got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God indeed. Thank you, Leslie. And now before Paul, it really is a great pleasure to have you back with us today, and I really am looking forward to what you're going to share. But let's just pray for you now before you speak. Lord, we just lift up to you Paul. We thank you for the gifts that you've given to him, for your word that you have put within him. And we pray now that you will anoint him in power by your Spirit. Lord, speak through him, that we may be enabled to hear what it is that you are saying to us this day. And Lord, may we be built up through Paul's words as your servants, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you, everyone else. Good to be with you again, and particularly to be able to speak to you about the Jewish Jesus. And as you can see, the title is Jesus the Jewish Child, as you probably worked out from the Matthew reading, in which there's a lot there about Jesus' childhood. Now, one of the things I find most fascinating about Bible study and therefore Bible teaching is looking at the relationship between the Old and the New Testaments, and in particular how the New Testament writers use the Old Testament scriptures. And that's why I think it's good to have two readings, in this case, one from Isaiah in the Old Testament, as well as from Matthew. If I've got time today, I'm going to link those together. But this is an ongoing series. Last time we started in Luke's Gospel and looked at what the angel said to Mary that was relevant to Jesus being born as King of the Jews. And now we're moving on a little bit into the chronology of Jesus's life. But we're going now to Matthew's Gospel, where we will be for at least two more sessions after this. Because Matthew in particular fascinates me by the way he uses the Hebrew scriptures, and in particular how he draws certain texts, passages, quotations out of the Old Testament in a very distinctive way, something that he does that the other Gospel writers don't do. And one of the things that make these most distinctive is that he seems to introduce a lot of them, 10 in fact, by the same introductory formula or little sentence in which he talks about something being fulfilled by the prophets. And these almost act like Matthew's own interpretive comments, little asides that he wants to give to us, particularly to express a sense of purpose within something that's been said in the past and that's happened since then, and in particular in the life of Jesus himself. So there's 10 of these, and there's going to be three or four of them today and more next time and more the time after until we've got through them. That particular introductory paragraph or little sentence, really, formula that he uses all the time is almost identical every time, just one or two little changes, but it roughly goes, so that it might be fulfilled as was spoken by the prophet. And I don't know if you noticed, but it occurred three times in our Matthew reading, in Matthew chapter 2. So if you've got that open, let's just pinpoint them again now, because there was one in verse 15, Matthew 2:15, and so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. And we don't have to go much further, only a couple of verses, the verses 17 and 18, where we read, then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. And then there's the quote from Jeremiah. And then there's another one towards the end of the same chapter, verse 23 of Matthew chapter 2. And he went and lived in a town called Nazareth, so was fulfilled what was said to the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. So there's three packed tightly together around this time of Jesus's life, basically as a young child. And as I said, this is unique amongst the gospel writers, that Matthew draws texts in this particular way. All the New Testament writers obviously try and apply the Old Testament, but Matthew's doing something rather distinctive and special here. Now, one other comment I need to make before we look at them is that if you try and look back yourself into the Old Testament and find those quotes, well, sometimes it's easy because there's footnote references to help you. Other times they're a bit trickier to find, perhaps. But you might notice sometimes the wording doesn't quite seem to match what you've got in your Old Testament translations. So a word or two about that, because it might put you off thinking, well, did he get it wrong or what's going on here? Well, as well as the Hebrew text of the time of the Old Testament scriptures, known as the Masoretic text, there was also a Greek version, a Greek translation of those scriptures that had been made in the century or two before Jesus, and it goes under the name of the Septuagint. So the Hebrew scriptures have been translated into Greek, and it's quite often that Greek version that gets put into our New Testament when it's quoted, simply because it's in the same language, in the Greek language. But Matthew sometimes seems to pick a bit from the Hebrew text, sometimes from the Septuagint Greek text, and sometimes he seems to mix it up, and even sometimes seems to do a little bit of his own translation of things. And that's because he knows what he's doing, for a start. He understands the scriptures, and he's trying to bring out a particular thought or a particular purpose behind it. So don't be put off if you find Matthew perhaps isn't quite quoting accurately. He may well be. He's just quoting from a different text. Or he may be doing something special himself in order to bring out a point. So what I'm going to do is take you through the three that are in Matthew chapter 2, and we'll see how far we get in terms of anything else. So in chapter 2 and verse 15, we have the first one of these. And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. Now, without a footnote reference, you might really be struggling to know exactly where you find that in the prophets. But if you have got a footnote reference, it tells you that it's chapter 11 and verse 1 of Hosea. Hosea chapter 11 and verse 1. Now, he's pretty well sticking to what the Hebrew text says here. He chooses the word son rather carefully. But if you know anything about Hosea, and I won't be surprised if you haven't quite read it recently, but if you look at chapter 11 at some point, and by the way, we couldn't do an Old Testament reading from every one of these, otherwise we'd have been here all day, so you may have to do some background reading yourself. But in Hosea chapter 11 and verse 1, you do get this little phrase, out of Egypt I called my son, which is very strange sort of thing to take, because if you read that chapter, this is not a predictive passage at all. There's nothing overtly prophetic about what Hosea is saying in this particular chapter, and it's certainly not a messianic prophecy that he's doing here. All the prophet seems to be doing in Hosea chapter 11 is reflecting on the Exodus as an historical event, and somehow Matthew wants to pick that up and make a point because of the connection that he finds between the fact that Jesus also went down to Egypt as a young child and then was brought back up again. It's almost though he wants to state that God preserved Jesus through this mini exile, if you like, as a sign of God's protection of Jesus and his preservation of him, and as a sign of his fatherhood over this special son that he had. So what happened to Israel in the past was repeated here in the person of Jesus, and Matthew just wants to draw our attention to that and then just leave it with us. And he just notices the similarity, if you like. The second one that he uses in this chapter, in verses 17 and 18, he's quoting Jeremiah. And again, you might need a footnote reference to make it clear exactly where, which is in chapter 31 and verse 15. I think my eyesight tells me that. So why is Matthew now choosing this reference from Jeremiah, and in particular linking it back with something that happened in the past? Because Jeremiah himself is reflecting upon a previous incident that's recorded in the book of Genesis. So sometimes you get layer upon layer of things. The Old Testament prophet is making a comment upon something, just like Hosea made a comment upon the Exodus and coming out of Egypt. What Jeremiah is making a comment on, Matthew is wanting to pick up as well, and say something similar also happened within the life of Jesus. So Jeremiah talks about Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. So what's this got to do with anything? Why Rachel and so on? And why does it link in with what happened around Bethlehem? Well, you may know that Rachel actually died in childbirth as she was on the way to Bethlehem, or just outside it. And that's in fact where she was originally buried, just outside Bethlehem. We later find actually in Samuel that her burial place was moved to another place called Zelzar. That's in 1 Samuel chapter 10. So although she was buried to start with, where she died in childbirth, just outside Bethlehem, her tomb was later recorded at being at Zelzar. And that, as far as scholars can tell, is very close to a place called Ramah, which is mentioned here in the quote from Jeremiah. So, and both places, Ramah and Zelzar, are close together, but they're not quite the same place as being near Jerusalem. Sorry, as being near Bethlehem. So what exactly is going on here? Rachel came to symbolize Jewish motherhood, or the idealization of it. She only gave birth to two of the tribes, or the founders of the tribes, but they were Joseph and Benjamin, and therefore they were very special. And so she was idealized almost as the great example of Jewish motherhood. But also perhaps because of the grief associated with her death during childhood, she came to symbolize the mothers who later on would weep, in particular, as Israel was taken off into exile. And in fact, that Ramah was on the route in which the exiles, the captives, were taken as they were taken off into Babylon. And you get this emphasis later on in Jeremiah as well. So Jeremiah is picking up the fact that the exile was such a dreadful thing to happen, that it was the equivalent of the mothers weeping over their lost sons in the same way that they wept over over Rachel's death in childbirth and so on. And Matthew again is picking up Jeremiah's comment on this to link it in with the slaughter that Herod did of the young children in Bethlehem. But Rachel, who's weeping for her children and great mourning as they went into and it represents them going into exile. If you read further in that chapter, chapter 31 of Jeremiah, later on she's told not to weep, and there is hope for her and her children. So as always, by quoting a little bit of a chapter, Matthew wants us to go back and read the whole chapter or the whole passage in order to get the bigger picture of what he's stating from here. In other words, later on in chapter 31, despite this great distress and despite the awfulness of the exile, there is hope, there is promise. And you probably know that in Jeremiah 31, you get the promise of the new covenant. So what we've got here in Matthew is, again, he wants to link Jesus, particularly even before Jesus can do anything, while he's still a child, things are happening which actually make sense within the context of God's entire plan and provision and purpose. The Messiah has escaped death at this point. God is looking after him. He is his true father. And the link in with what happened to the exile is that these very significant events in the life of Israel are now making more sense, again, within the life of Jesus. I'll explain more about that later on. But let's look at the third quotation to build up the pattern even more. Right at the end of the chapter, you get, so was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. Now, this time I can guarantee, well, not quite guarantee, but you probably don't have a footnote reference. And if you listen very carefully there, you'll realize that what Matthew says would be fulfilled through the prophets, plural, because he's not offering an exact quotation from Jeremiah or Isaiah or anywhere else. He's actually giving a sort of summary rather than an actual specific quotation, a summary of a common prophetic theme. And that therefore takes a little bit more unpacking, because it's not like going to one passage and saying, oh yes, that's what he's quoting, that's what that meant. We can't link it directly to, say, the Exodus, as we do with Hosea, or the exile, as we do through Jeremiah. So what is going on in that particular verse? A nice little sort of throwaway comment almost at the end, which Matthew loves to do. But he's trying to explain something to us. Jesus eventually went and lived in a town called Nazareth. But Nazareth is not mentioned at all in the Old Testament. In fact, it was regarded as something of a non-entity, really, a sort of backwater in geographical terms. So he's going to become very special because Jesus went there. But what Matthew wants to do is link it with the fact that Jesus would be called a Nazarene. Now, this is rather tricky. Let me try and explain what's going on here. You're not called a Nazarene just because you live or brought up in Nazareth. This is not like being called a Cockney because you come from London, or a Geordie because you come from Newcastle. There is no actual link at all between Nazareth and Nazarene in the general sense. So what is going on here? Well, there's a bit of a sort of wordplay. You can tell that from just listening to the words Nazareth, Nazarene. And the Hebrew language, many of you will know this, is based upon the consonant roots, which tells you how words are linked and what they actually mean. So what we've got here is a bit of a, I think a bit of a pun almost, or a wordplay by Matthew, because Jesus went to a totally unknown place, totally unexpected, very small town area where you would not expect him to come from. And from there, Matthew is telling us something. So the similarity between the words is based upon the root, Nazareth, Nazarene, and the phrase netzer, or the word, based upon enzora, means branch. And netzer is a branch. And the idea of the Messiah being a branch is very common within the prophets. Not just a prophet, but in several places, the idea of the branch is a good significance of Messiah. And you'll find that you might know one or two of them, but you can check this out yourself in Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 2, chapter 11 and verse 1. And it's again in Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 5, chapter 33, verse 8. I know these are going too quickly for you, But it's just to give you an idea that in Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Zechariah, there are prophets there that have made a comment upon the fact that that the Messiah will be a branch of the root of Jesse and of David's line and so on. So it seems, and it's a bit obscure in some ways, but it seems that Matthew here is trying to tell us something about the fact that Jesus will be regarded as the branch, just simply based upon the wordplay between the place where he actually was brought up. So in all those three, we're beginning, I think, to get a bit of a picture of what Matthew is actually trying to do here. He's trying to present Jesus as in continuity with the Old Testament scriptures, as a fulfillment of them, and therefore to some extent of what God's plans and purposes have always been about. He's trying to link it together very, very carefully indeed. And so this idea of illuminating the historical events through the Old Testament passages gives him his very distinctive way of writing his gospel in terms of a fulfillment. And this idea of a fulfillment is very dominant within Matthew's gospel. It's almost his trademark, and he's out to explore what fulfillment really means, and he's using a lot of different Old Testament passages and places, almost to us it seems like he's drawing them quite, not quite at random, but very loosely in order to build up a picture. Now, when you hear the word fulfill or fulfillment, I wonder what it brings to your mind, because there's many different possible definitions of fulfillment. At the simplest level, it's just there was a prediction and it happened, therefore it's fulfilled. Something was predicted and it's come true. Well, that's one way of understanding fulfillment, but it's not actually the one that Matthew is really using here, and it's not always the best one. Another way in which you can use the word fulfillment is to say, I've completed or discharged my undertaking or obligation. I said I would do this and I've done it, so that's it. You draw a line under it, it's been completed. My duty has been discharged, I've fulfilled it. But in biblical terms, and in particular what Matthew is doing here, he sees fulfillment as the consummation of a promise, especially covenant-based promises. And this is most significant and most crucial for Matthew. Jesus is demonstrating fulfillment, not because a large number of predictions have been verified in him, but because in him we see the perfecting and the realization of the entire goal of God's plan, which he began in Israel. And in Jesus, it's going to come to a great climax of all that God has planned and prepared and done. It's a consummation by God himself in Christ of the covenant promises that he's made in the past. So it's not a matter of prediction and verification, which actually is a very sort of, I don't know, it leaves us a bit cold sometimes. This is a prediction and it's happened. Okay, fine. But a promise that God has said and the way he brings it into fruition is something that's much more dynamic and much more, if like, theologically appropriate. It's about God's ongoing relationship and commitment. And I think it's within this larger context, which Matthew understands very well, that he can employ these Old Testament passages and sort of mold them a little bit to the story that he's telling, because he can use events that are not in themselves making any reference predictively to anything still to come again. They're relating to things in the past. They're not what we might sometimes call proper messianic prophecies. It's just based upon the fact that God has done this in the past and he's still working things out. And in what we find in Jesus, we find that God is continuing to fulfill his promises. So for Matthew, this is all about what we call salvation history. God has started a process in which he is bringing people to himself. He is saving them. And there is a oneness, a uniqueness about God's plan And the story of Jesus fulfills that. It fits it. It brings it to a climax. It's not contrary to it. It's not separate from it. It's not plan B, if you like. And so Matthew wants us to see the story of Jesus within the broader context of everything that God has been doing, that he started with Israel, and so on. Now, what this means is that there is often what we might call a fuller sense or deeper meaning that comes out of digging into Old Testament passages in order to make them more relevant to what's happening now. And this isn't just something that Christians have done. In fact, it was very much a common practice amongst the Jews. And Matthew, being very much a Jewish believer, writing probably to other Jews, knew exactly what he was doing with these texts in order to make them more apparent to his readership. Now, what he's not doing is trying to find different meanings. He's not scrapping them and saying, ah, really, they meant this rather than that. He's actually revealing new levels of significance within what was already said and has already happened. So he's not doing something contrary to the original passages of Scripture. He's actually linking that purpose with the new promise and fulfillment that's to be seen in Jesus. And what Matthew is doing is he's using all his experience, his knowledge, and so on to try and make other people aware of this wider context that Jesus has brought to things. And one of the things that comes out of this is that there is this strong link between Jesus and Israel. Now, some people might want to make a lot of this and some less so, but it's almost as though when Jesus came, he began to repeat or recapitulate the main events of the life of Israel, because he was going to fulfill what was given to Israel. And when they failed, Jesus was going to succeed. In that sense, Matthew sees in the history of Jesus a recapitulation of everything that happened to Israel, but now with a greater purpose, eventually, as we know, to the Gentiles as well, through the whole world. And so he wants to link very carefully and clearly Jesus in with Israel, because that's where the fulfillment becomes most prominent. And that's his main, if you like, theological perspective. He's not just alluding to one or two things in their past, but as he puts those before us in the context of Jesus, he's actually saying their history as a whole, everything that God has done so far, has a correspondence now with what he's doing in Jesus. And so he offers us these quotations, these formula things, not as isolated predictions, not even as proof texts, which somehow are given in the past and then launched forward so that they land eventually on a target in the New Testament or in Jesus himself. He wants to show that the whole pattern of Israel's story is gathered up, reproduced in Jesus. If you like, it's filled up to the full by Jesus' birth, ministry, death, and resurrection. So as he goes through his gospel, he's going to repeatedly pick out these passages in order to show us how Jesus fulfills everything that God has done so far, and that he will bring success to what God has indeed started. So that's taken you through those three in Matthew chapter 2. And as I thought, I haven't got time for another one today, but that's the great joy of coming back again in a month's time, because we read something from Isaiah chapter 7, wasn't it? Isaiah chapter 7. And some of you may be thinking, well, he's given us three of them from Matthew chapter 2, but he's missed one. Why didn't he go back to Matthew chapter 1 and give us verse 23? Matthew chapter 1 and verse 23 is a very well-known quotation that Matthew uses, and it comes out of Isaiah chapter 7. But what I wanted to do today was to give you, through these three little examples, a sort of survey and an overview of what's really going on in the gospel. And next time, but I'll advise you to look at it in advance for yourself, we read the whole of Isaiah chapter 7 because we need, probably read the first 17 verses of it, because we need that context to understand what's going on when Matthew quotes one little bit of it, and in some ways he changes some of it, and in another way you could say, but he didn't get it, or at least this didn't really happen in the way that Matthew wants. So I'm leaving that one with you to do a bit of extra thinking. I hope you've understood what I've said, and those first three have given you not only the flavour of what's going on, but the understanding behind it, so that you can try this for yourself. Have a look again at Isaiah 7 at some point and put it in the whole context and see if you can work out why Matthew in particular wanted to draw something from there in the quote that he does in chapter 1 and verse 23. But say, we'll pick that up in a bit more detail next time, and we'll work through some more of these fascinating quotations that Matthew finds in the Old Testament, which give us this greater sense of Jesus as the fulfillment of God's plan and purpose that he began in Israel, that Israel very much was part of, but they didn't succeed in the way that Jesus is going to succeed. He really is the fulfillment of everything that God has got for us in him. So I will finish there today. Thank you very much. And hand back to, I suppose, to Linda. Is that right?
That is right, Paul. Yes, thank you. Paul, that was absolutely fascinating. And I'm looking forward to part two of this and to hear what you've got to say about Isaiah. Tremendous. Thank you. Everybody, Paul is going to be stopping on afterwards for a brief time. So we're not going to have breakout rooms today. So you can follow this up and explore any points that were raised for you where you'd like a little bit more explanation if you stay on after the service. Yep. Again, thank you, Paul. Well, it seems entirely appropriate at this point we declare our faith in God, in the Lord, in what God is doing for us. And again, as we make this declaration of faith, let us consciously stand before the Lord, stand in the gap, and let this be a declaration of faith of our nation. As God has been faithful to us, as we've just heard so clearly, let us now affirm our faithfulness to him. But let it be not just for our own parts, let it be for this nation, because this is a spiritual battle that we are in. So stay muted, but we say together, we believe in the Holy Scriptures as originally given by God, divinely inspired, infallible, entirely trustworthy, and the supreme authority in all matters of faith and conduct. We believe in one God, eternally existent in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in our Lord Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, his virgin birth, his sinless human life, his divine miracles, his vicarious and atoning death, his bodily resurrection, his ascension, his mediatorial work, and his personal return in power and glory. We believe in the salvation of lost and sinful man through the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, by faith apart from works, and regeneration by the Holy Spirit. We believe in the Holy Spirit, by whose indwelling the believer is enabled to live a holy life, to witness and work for the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe in the unity of the Spirit of all true believers, the Church, the body of Christ. We believe in the resurrection of both the saved and the lost, they that are saved unto the resurrection of life, they that are lost unto the resurrection of damnation. This is our faith. and here we stand. And may that faith be proclaimed to the highest heavens. May that faith be made manifest here on earth in our own nation. Amen. So now I'm going to invite Philip to come and lead us in our prayers, please.
Thank you, Linda. Let's pray. O God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, how great thou art, and what a privilege it is to be able to come into your very throne at any time of day or night. You are Elohim, who created the heavens and the earth and all they contain. You are Adonai Shaddai, the Lord Jesus Christ. You are a three-in-one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Lord Jesus Christ is Lord of lords, King of kings, the great shepherd of the sheep. Lord Jesus, we ask, please, that you will send the Holy Spirit to us today to enable us to gaze fully into your face, not just this day, but in the weeks and months and years to come until you call us home. Lord Jesus, we thank you anew for your sacrifice on the cross and for your resurrection. Be seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven. We acknowledge with gratitude that we are blood bought by the shed blood of the Lord Jesus, and we are in blood covenant with you. We thank you that you are a covenant-fulfilling God, and we rejoice before you for all that Paul has unfolded to us today about those covenant promises that are fulfilled in Christ and are yes and amen. Father, today we turn to you at a grave time in the history of our nation. Just when we think things can't get any worse, they do. We are in a terrible state. We are defenseless before our enemies, and we are mired in shame. We confess before you that the nation is in this condition simply because the church has not been all that you wish it to be. We have not stood for the truth of your word. We have not manifested the kingdom as we ought. We have failed in countless ways through what we have done and what we have failed to do. Lord Jesus, we repent before you. We weep before you for what we have done to deliver this most wonderful nation and our poor suffering people into the hands of our enemies and your enemies. But God, with you there is always hope. With you there is always a way out. With you there is always the but God. And so we turn to you now, please, to beg you for your mercy upon this land and its people. For your power to work afresh through your body in this land, Holy Spirit. We ask, please, that you will blow with power on this nation. We ask that the rain of the Spirit will fall afresh in this land, and that the first fruits of this will be that the church in this nation stands up a mighty army. When the prophet Ezekiel stood in the valley of dry bones, you asked him, Son of man, can these bones live? And he said, O sovereign Lord, thou alone knowest. Prophesy to the breath, you said to your prophet. And today we wish to be ones who will prophesy to the breath, so that bone may come together with bone, that flesh and sinew may come upon those bones, and so that you, Lord God, may again breathe fresh life into these slain. We take now the power and authority that we have as children of the living God and as servants of the Lord Jesus, to use his name. We have power of attorney to use the name of Jesus. And in the name of Jesus now, we cancel the lie of Allahu Akbar that has been spoken in this nation. We declare it a lie. It is not Allah who is greater. It is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who is not just greater, but greatest. It is the Lord Jesus Christ, who is Lord of lords and King of kings, and stands above all principalities and powers, at the feet of whom everybody must bow the knee, either voluntarily or in due course by compulsion. We proclaim that the Lord Jesus Christ is King in our nation and none other. This nation belongs to him, and Allah and any other false god shall not have this nation. We declare it to be so. We proclaim it to be so. We decree it to be so, because the Lord God himself in his counsels in heaven has determined that it shall be so. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Father, we thank you for your protective hand upon Israel and the Jewish people. How can it be the people of this world cannot work out how the Jewish people still exist as a nation? But your prophecy has been fulfilled. Yes, a nation was born in a day and brought forth in a month. And now you are causing Israel to do the things that you require Israel to do in these latter days. And as it is in Israel, so it shall be, so it must be in the church. Father, we ask, please, that you will do in the church in this nation what you are doing even now in Israel, that you will cause us to realize that we are at war and we simply cannot get out of it. We must stand up and we must fight. We must contend for the faith that was once and all for all given to the saints. We must contend for this nation. We must contend against the demonic powers that seek to work against the purposes of Almighty God. Oh Lord, send your spirit into your body now, please, to make us stand up, to bring us into that army formation that we're supposed to be, that we may be ones who fight valiantly for Christ in these days. God, we rejoice before you at that scripture that Leslie read to us from Isaiah, when the armies of Israel marched up to fight against Jerusalem but could not overcome it. There is no man, no principality, no power, no demon that may overcome what you, Lord God, have determined they shall not overcome. And they shall not have this nation in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Philip. Powerful prayers. Amen and amen and amen. So let us bring those together with the words that Jesus himself gave to us, daughters. We say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And as we feel the Lord's mighty hand upon us, as we feel his hands over this earth, that he's moving in blessing and in love, that he has not forsaken us, but that his is the battle. So now we come before him with our needs, with the needs of others known to us. We lift up to him all those who need his touch, safe in the knowledge that he loves us and that he listens and that he will help. So I'm going to invite you to unmute in a minute and to speak out the names of all those for whom you wish the Lord's touch this day, whether it's for physical healing, whether it's for emotional healing, whether it's for encouragement, for compassion, whether it's hope in grief. Let us bring before the Lord those who we wish his touch this day. So we bring to the Lord the sick and suffering, those who are heavy laden, those who mourn and grieve, those who are weary, tired, anxious. None of their needs go unnoticed by our God. So may the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ bless and restore all those troubled in body, mind, or spirit that we now name before him. So now, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the power of the Spirit, may God in his perfect compassion restore all these we have named aloud and in our hearts, and speedily send them complete healing of soul and body. Let healing come speedily, and let us all say, Amen. Well, as we draw towards the end of our service, we're going to have another song of worship. All that remains is to give the blessing and dismissal. So we say, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And we say together, in the name of Christ, Amen.